decades of telling children to stop pointing laser pointers at people's eyes, researchers did so to themselves. For science. But with a very special science laser, and also it let them see a color some might call unnatural. First, though, how does color vision work? Well, like any gamer's computer, it works on RGB. Our photosensitive cone cells in our retina have three different kinds of photopigment proteins. When one of these pigment proteins absorbs a photon, it changes, causing a molecular cascade that ultimately transmits a signal to our brain's nervous system. Photon hits pigment protein, protein changes, that signal tells us that colored light is happening. Each of our three little cone opsins is a bit different in its chemical makeup, which is why it takes photons of different frequencies to get each one to change shape. Here are the different wavelengths of light that interact with our three little cone photopigments. Each has a peak wavelength, but it'll still activate outside that peak. It just takes more energy. And unlike other sensory systems, photoreceptors have gradations of membrane potential, which allows for degrees of transmitter signaling. You can see that two of our three cone opsins, red and green, have tons of spectral overlap. That is to say, they'll both accept photons from that overlapping range of wavelengths. That's because red and green cone proteins have 96% identical protein sequences. They're just 15 amino acids different. So it's not surprising that the photons that will excite them are also pretty similar. Our lonely blue cone opsin over there only shares 43% identity with its two buddies, and indeed it takes photons of a very different range of wavelengths to get that little protein to wiggle and transduce signal. Incidentally, it is also on a different human chromosome. Blue opsin protein's on chromosome 7, while the other two are both on the X chromosome. And yes, that's why some forms of color blindness, including the ones involving your red and green cones, are sex-linked, while blue-yellow color blindness involving your blue cone protein over there on chromosome 7 affects all karyotypes at similar rates. Even though we have all of these three photopigment proteins, our retina's cone cells each specialize in one of the three pigment proteins. So when the cell transmits a signal to our nervous system, it's information about one color band in particular. This is a retinal mosaic, an illustration of how those specialized cone cells are distributed across our retina. You may notice that we have lots of red optimized cone cells and the fewest blue optimized cone cells, with no blue cone cells at all in the center of our vision. Some retinal conditions go after our blue cone cells in particular, and we can even lose a bunch of our blue cone cells as we age, which is, scientifically speaking, trippy as hell. I don't feel like I see color differently. Your retinas, though, are just transmitting raw data. Your brain does all the post-processing to turn it into what we understand as color. The leading theory for how our brain does this is called the opponent process, based on which combinations of color-specialized cone cells activate and how much. If your red cones activate, but your blue and green ones don't activate all that much, that's going to be red, right? Then, as the wavelengths get shorter, those photons are going to activate both your red and green cones roughly the same, but not your blue ones at all, and that'll be yellow. As the wavelengths get shorter, the activation pattern changes, with less and eventually no activation of that red cone cell. And our brain interprets that combination information as color. And just to answer the magenta problem. Nothing ever said that an object could only send one wavelength of photon, did it? Magenta objects are reflecting blue wavelength photons and red wavelength photons, even though we can't see what lets the red and blue be separate. So, with magenta, the individual photon is one or the other. It activates one or the other photoreceptor in our retina, but both are being activated. But say, with a magenta shirt, it's still absorbing all the photons in the green wavelength, so you don't get partial activation of the green cone cell or anything. And that's kind of the cool thing about this whole cone cell to brain setup. Even though there's no magenta wavelength of light, our brain still has an answer for what happens if our blue and red cone cells are sending signal and our green one isn't. So we have these three little color channels in our retina, and at either edge, you'll get pretty much only blue or only red activation. But other than that, it's all overlap, right? But take a moment and think of the middle child here. If you look across the spectrum, green always has the potential for some overlap. It's never just activated alone. That makes sense. Again, our red and green photopigment proteins are 96% identical, but like, even at peak green cone, those red cones are still very strongly activated. Our brain makes good use of that data. We're really good at discriminating between colors in those wavelengths because we can pick up on all those subtle differences in red versus green cone cell activation patterns. But like, poor green cone. If you have no red cones, your green cones have to pick up all the slack. And if you have three functional cone types, that green cone never gets a solo moment like the other two do. Which, finally, brings us back to this week's story, scientists lasering their eyeballs for science. I've been showing you all those retinal mosaics like the one just now for red cone deficiency. So the thing is, we can map those to a cell-by-cell level in actual living human eyeballs, which is already just an unspeakably cool thing. Remember how we said there were no blue cones in the center of your vision? Here's a figure from a paper that used this adaptive optics technique to prove that in a living human retina. The yellow asterisk at the bottom right of the image is the central vision, and you can see how the upper section of the retina farther from the center of the foveola has some blue response, while the bottom graph in that central high cone density part of the retina did not. I mean, we'd seen this in tissue samples before, but like, we saw it in a working, living eye. So step one in this week's story, simply live image a couple thousand individual cone cells on a living human retina. As a preparatory step, they said, as if that's no big deal. And I'm already starting to get big draw the rest of the owl energy from this manuscript. Because the next step is sending what they call laser microdoses of visible light with intensities targeting at activating this cell to this level in particular, while simultaneously motion tracking the eye so that they could adjust the cell-by-cell pattern accordingly. The visible light laser they used for these laser microdoses is one color. It's a 488-millimeter nanometer laser, so like this cyan-looking color. But if we go back once again to our cone cell spectra, if you look at the activation pattern on our graph, all three of our cone cells can be activated with photons of this wavelength. It's actually sitting closest to any kind of a sweet spot where they are all off peak. So if you're hitting an individual cell with this laser with enough intensity, it will activate no matter what cone type it is. Now, there's some degree of fractional leak in this process. Light aimed at one cell that hits other cells, and it's not insignificant. The prototype is modeled to deposit, quote, 40% of the light from each microdose into the target cone, with the remainder going uniformly to all other cones. But they're still so precise with this technique that the control condition for this experiment is, oh, we jittered the light a little, so it sends the signal to a cell 2 cells away from the intended target. And like, are you kidding me? 2 cells! With the jitter control condition, you're no longer sending this very precise cell-by-cell signal, and the visual effect collapses. You just see the color of the laser, that cyan from earlier, versus a full-on image or video customized cell-by-cell for just your little eyeballs. And it's in full color because 488 nanometer wavelengths will activate all three of those cone types, and an individual red cone cell can't actually distinguish between high-intensity 488 nanometer wavelength or, say, very low-intensity red. Either one makes the photopigment wiggle about the same amount, and to the extent it's activated, the red cone cell releases transmitter for your brain to figure it out in post. Which normally works just fine, because our color vision is typically coordinated across these cells, because our visual processing isn't built around the assumption that we're catching photons that are emitted or reflected in our surroundings. It's not built around the assumption that individually gift-wrapped photons targeted to cell-type-specific intensities for each individual cone cell in your retina while tracking eye movement to send that laser microdose to the specific cell in question. Because that would be a wild and impossible thing. Except we can totally do it. And because these scientists can do this, they do something that only photons emitted or reflected in our surroundings never could. They activated only the green cone cells. Again, there's still some fractional leak, so it's not like strictly 1,000,000% only green cone cells, but it's enough for this activation pattern that isn't seen in nature. So what does our brain do with it? Well, they called the color OLO because they are trying to activate red 0, green 1, blue 0. So that basically committed scientific leap speak. But the result is, apparently, a blue-green of unprecedented saturation. And I can't show you anything like what that looks like, because, you know, I don't have the super precise individual cell laser, and neither does your computer monitor. I guess it makes sense for our brains to go blue-green as the answer to only green cones activate, because, I mean, well, the green is active without the red, and less red probably means something's more blue. When someone without red cones has this activation pattern, that person's brain is used to it. Only green, no red, no blue is the default for someone with protanopia looking at, say, orange. Though, even then, those green photoreceptors aren't strongly activated by orange. In fact, we don't know exactly what would happen if someone with color vision deficiency got a hold of this. The 5 participants who were involved in this study do have normal color vision. All the participants were involved in this study in some way, 3 of them as authors, but were not made aware of the test conditions for the experiments they were involved in as participants. And just so it's said, I joke about shining lasers into their eyeballs, but this whole thing went through institutional review boards at 2 different universities. This was not scientists wilding out shining lasers into their eyeballs to try to see new colors. I mean, it was that. It was exactly that. But, like, safety happened. And that's a very good thing, because these researchers do hope to see how this device works for colorblind people. This thing hacks our brain's color vision processing, and these researchers are curious about how the brain, with all its neuroplasticity, might respond. If you have no red cones, but you have this device signaling to some of your green cones with one pattern and some with another, could your brain start interpreting signals from those cones in trichromatic color vision? Could we do the same thing on people with trichromatic color vision? to see as if we had four cones? This whole thing is a highly technical feat that stands on the shoulders of giants already. Remember, this only works because we can apparently map the living human retina cone cell by cone cell. But this project builds on that and dozens of others that came before it, and it's just genuinely astounding. It's like climbing to the top of the mountain and then looking over how far we've climbed. Like, this is a thing that science and engineering and mathematics and technology all came together to do so that we can map the living human retina and send laser microdoses to individual cone cells to see things beyond the natural human gamut. And that's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. But while you marvel at it, just do me one favor. Don't try to replicate it. No, I mean it. Put the laser pointer down. Put it down.